I think of any new show that's been like out there right now, this is, sounds like the scariest, and it's not even supposed to be a horror show. What was the appeal?
I think just that, the fact that it's so real, the fact that it's actually happening. I mean, how do you? It sounds outlandish, and the character I play is trying to warn everybody that this thing is potentially catastrophically dangerous, and yet he's a little nutty, so nobody really believes him. So it's a kind of a classic. Scenario where we have a limited amount of time to catch something that's growing more and more dangerous, and it's real. It's actually, you know, it's potential to, and it's totally relevant, and it's timely and on people's minds, and, and the script was great. I mean, that we all read was terrific.
Did they give you like a backstory of where he came from and all that kind of stuff yet?
Yeah. He knows.
Nobody else does.
Well, they gave us a I mean, I read the script, and then we read a sort of a Bible, as they call it, going forward. But not so much a backstory. I mean, you kind of cook it up in your head, and you learn what's relevant.
Did they make you do any research for this, though?
I did. They didn't really make us. I read what I could get my hands on before we did it, and wormholed my way around the internet, and watched podcasts, Sam Harris and Elon Musk and Bill Gates and Stephen Hawking, and listened to what all these people had to say about the subject, which is scary.
Also, it's not a whole lot. There wasn't a whole lot of sci-fi, fantastical sci-fi. Like, it's very much now.
Yeah,
our phones are recording this conversation right now. It knows what we bought at Whole Foods and what we watched that night on television. So, like, it's not that. There isn't a fantastical element. Like, this is real.
There's just the terror of where is it going to go, right? When all of a sudden an intelligence like that goes rogue and has its own ideas of what it wants to do and where it wants to go and what kind of damage it wants to do, then we really aren't a part of that plan. What does that look like? And what kind of damage control do we have to do? And that's what John's character and my character kind of team up to tackle that. I think that's ultimately the really terrifying part, right? It's kind of like a silent killer, because we all have phones, we all use our computers, and we kind of download that app anyway, even though we know the Russians are listening because we want to see ourselves old. So we allow it.
I've seen myself.
Well, I regret it for both reasons, for the Russians and for the way that I looked. But it is how much we allow it in and what that looks like. Really not that far into the future, right? The threat and the stakes of something like that taking control, which really makes a lot of sense. If you build something that can exponentially make itself smarter and bigger, it will outsmart us.
Yeah.
And
also, how can human nature self-police itself when we like using it? Like, you can't. I don't know about you guys, but like, I travel a lot, I do a lot. The idea of not being able to get on my computer or get on my phone to just do basic things, including figure out where the restaurant is, it's like, there's a lot of things I didn't download the Face app, but I did look at WhatsApp on my way here to contact all my friends in various countries.
Well, did the characters, you guys know each other before this came about, or is like you're supposed to meet through what's happening in the investigation?
We're brothers.
Okay.
So we met.
Yeah.
And then
you told.
Yeah.
And then my character kind of stumbles onto John really because she's just recently suffered a loss of a man who is a father figure to her, essentially died in a very freak-ish car accident, and in her investigating that, she realizes there's something fishy, strange about this, and that leads her to John's character, who pretty immediately realizes this is my program, it's out of control, and it's a very strange thing for her to try to accept, but she stays engaged because she really wants to know what happened to her friend. And I think it's kind of a merging of two very different kinds of people, because John's character knows the program he's built and knows artificial intelligence extremely intelligent. intelligent of himself. And Shay's character is, it knows people. You know, her specialty is behavior and what makes people tick. And those are actually, as smart as John's character is, he doesn't have that connection to people as much as, I don't know if he would even like it, but he doesn't have it. So eventually it becomes very complimentary in taking on this kind of.
I have an illness that is also makes me paranoid and have hallucinations, and so when I start warning everybody about this thing, they just think I'm crazy. We've had a long history of my erratic behavior. And he's, you know, this has been going on for a long time, and I don't know her. And she comes to me with the death of her friend, and he was trying to say, "This, I think this is artificial intelligence, and I think it doesn't want anyone to know it exists." And she sees this in a mind, and he's trying to find his way to me. So she doesn't know why her friend wanted to come to me. And I look at this thing and say, well, I wrote that program. And so we need each other, all of us, to put this thing together. And, you know, it's like Manny said, if you knew somebody that knew all your bank accounts, knew all your, you know, passwords, knew all your friends, knew what you did for a job, knew how much money you made, knew all your weaknesses, all your secrets, would you let that person into your house? And then, well, you already did, because it's, you know, it's all right there. So, yeah, I mean, it's dramatic, and yet it's mundane. I mean, it's at the same time.